From ABC, this is World News Tonight. With Max Robinson in Chicago, Peter Jennings in Warsaw with the foreign news, and a special report on the crisis in Poland. And from our desk in Washington, Frank Reynolds.
Good evening. The price of gasoline and home heating oil is going up again. That became clear today when the OPEC ministers meeting in Indonesia agreed to raise their prices by $2 to $3 a barrel, which means probably another 2 cents a gallon for gasoline and heating oil in this country. The Saudi Arabian oil minister, Sheikh Yamani, said a broad agreement was reached. However, the OPEC ministers are also dealing with disagreements among themselves. We have a report from Mike Lee in Bali.
A sunrise on the island of Bali promises a day free of worries and a pace of life geared to the steamy December heat of Indonesia. There's more than coconuts in the palm groves here. Machine gun mounted armored trucks are parked discreetly out of sight of the heavily guarded compound where OPEC's 13 oil ministers met today. Talk of raising oil prices for the outside world and lowering internal tension over the Persian Gulf War between OPEC members Iraq and Iran. The chief Iranian oil minister, Mohammad Jawad Bakir Tughanian, was unable to attend because he's been captured by Iraqi forces. So angry Iranian oil delegates put the minister's picture in his empty chair. The Iraqis did not take the bait, but stared straight ahead.
Once the oil ministers had gotten rid of reporters and cameramen, the real wheeling and dealing began, and they had plenty to talk about and worry about.
The cost of oil is going up again, with Saudi Arabia's Sheikh Yamani tonight the first to announce he's raising his price, believed to be a moderate increase. But the OPEC hawks will demand even more for their crude. And OPEC itself will try to soak up enough of the tranquility of this island to hold itself together at a time when power politics and a desert war are drawing the cartel in two directions. Mike Lee, ABC News, at the OPEC meeting in Bali.
In the war between Iran and Iraq, the senior military commander said today his forces would continue to hit oil installations in Iraq. The chief of staff for Iran said this was retaliation for Iraqi attacks on economic targets in Iran. The Gulf War is now in its 85th day. The hostages have just spent their 408th day in captivity. Iran's president, Abu Hassan Bani-Sadr, said today it was America's fault their release was being delayed. In London, with the full details of the president's news conference today, here's John Laurence.
Bani-Sadr blamed the delay in freeing the hostages on what he called those who hold real power in the United States. The Iranian president said the solution to the problem seems simple. The U.S. must return the estimated $13 billion of Iranian assets now frozen in American and European banks. Bani-Sadr said he was not referring to the private wealth of the late Shah.
The responses of the United States to the conditions must be very clear. Otherwise, no Iranian can accept any ambiguity in the way the United States responds to the conditions. In short, we must get the money we have in the United States before the crisis is resolved.
The latest Iranian position on the hostage negotiations is expected any day. John Laurence, ABC News, London.
This is Barrie Dunsmore in Washington. U.S. officials closely involved with the Iranian negotiations have told ABC News that it doesn't matter what President Bani-Sadr says about the hostage issue, it's irrelevant. These officials say that the Iranian president was badly burned last spring when he tried to get his government to take over control of the hostages. In this latest round of indirect talks with Iran, he is not involved. And U.S. officials believe he may not even have been told by Prime Minister Rajai what the U.S. proposals are. Meantime, U.S. officials feel that contacts with Iran may be about to enter a new phase. It's believed that Iran now has all the clarifications of the U.S. position it needs. Therefore, the Iranian commission is expected to either accept or reject the U.S. offer, or turn it back to the Iranian parliament with a recommendation to accept or reject. The mood among officials here today suggests that no one is betting that the U.S. proposals will be accepted. Barrie Dunsmore, ABC News, the State Department.
Families of the hostages are back in their homes across the nation after meeting with State Department officials over the weekend. In Wisconsin, the father of hostage Kevin Hermening says the group came away convinced the State Department is working hard to resolve the situation, and he is still hopeful. Well, still ahead, a flap over a Teamster official named to the Reagan transition team, and a baseball slugger sets a record off the diamond.
ABC's World News Tonight, brought to you by Brim Decaffeinated Coffee. If you love good coffee, why stop at half a cup? Fill your cup to the rim with the rich taste of Brim.
Your pool's going to be ready sooner than expected, Miss Martin.
Terrific, Ken. Have some coffee.
Whoa.
Only half a cup? Don't you like my coffee?
I love the rich taste. It's the caffeine I can do without.
You happen to be drinking Brim decaffeinated coffee.
This is Brim?
This is Brim, and it's decaffeinated, so you don't have to stop at half a cup.
If it tastes this rich, I don't want to stop. Here, fill it to the rim.
With Brim?
Fill your cup to the rim with the rich taste of Brim.
Jigs Formula 44D, please.
Helen, with this nasty cough, plus congestion, I need...
Formula 44D.
But Helen, I need a decongestant, not just strong cough medicine.
You need Formula 44D. It's strong like Formula 44, has the strongest non-narcotic cough suppressant you can buy, plus ingredients to help unstuff your nose and loosen up for chest congestion.
That's what I said. Formula 44D, strong for coughs, plus congestion.
President-elect Reagan will spend this week in California, and members of his transition team say there will be no more cabinet appointments until at least Wednesday. But there was some controversy today about a transition team official. He's a Teamster vice president from Cleveland who's been named to Reagan's economic affairs group. Charles Gibson has details.
They announced it with a press release this morning. Jackie Presser, a Teamster's vice president, to be a senior advisor to the economic affairs group of the Reagan transition. And as shown by the transition's own chart, that means Presser will be an advisor in the transition at the Labor Department. Problem is, Presser, for more than 2 years, has been a named defendant in a civil suit brought by Labor, charging the Teamsters Central State Pension Fund with a breach of fiduciary trust, charged with making tens of millions of dollars in questionable loans to Las Vegas establishments and underworld figures. As a result of that suit, Presser was forced to resign as a trustee of the Teamsters Fund. Presser himself has reputed underworld connections. In a San Francisco trial this year, this man, James the Weasel Fratiano, said that in a conversation, Presser, quote, told me himself that I don't do nothing unless Blackie tells me. Fratiano did not name Blackie except to say he was the boss of Cleveland's La Cosa Nostra, the mafia. Presser has denied mafia connections. And indeed, Presser, who made $270,000 as the 15th vice president of the Teamsters last year, has never been convicted of a crime. But what is his reputation?
There's been a history of investigations, of sometimes murders, of criminal activity, which it certainly seems that there's a pattern that that Presser is heavily involved in it.
Transition officials say Presser will serve only as an advisor to the Economic Affairs Group as a sounding board for ideas about labor, adding he won't actually set foot in the Labor Department. You must understand, said one spokesman, he comes from the Teamsters, the first union that endorsed us. Charles Gibson, ABC News, Washington.
Two former high-ranking FBI officials today were fined but not sent to prison for ordering illegal break-ins nearly 10 years ago. Each could have been sentenced to jail for 10 years and could have been fined $10,000. But the judge decided on a lesser penalty for both. Here's the story from Mike Von Fram.
Mark Felt, one-time second-in-command, was fined $5,000. Edward Miller, one-time chief of intelligence, $3,500. Both found guilty of illegally approving what the FBI calls black bag jobs, break-ins. Felt bristled at the suggestion that it was a light sentence.
But remember that I'm now a convicted felon, and I've got to live with that for I don't know how long. So I don't regard it as a light sentence. I regard it as a very serious blemish on my career.
It was after demonstrations like these in the late 60s that the FBI began a hunt for members of the militant Weather Underground. Felt and Miller approved some 9 break-ins without the approval of the courts, the president, or the attorney general. But throughout the trial, the men claimed they were acting for the good of the country, and Miller says he's proud of the way he served the FBI.
It was proud when we were in it, and it's still proud. And I don't think that there will be any lasting effect on the FBI.
The Society of Former FBI Agents raised more than $1 million to defend Miller and Felt, and both men say they will ask the Society for more money to appeal. Mike Von Fram, ABC News, Washington.
and golden light. And I will feel this way forever.
Share the fantasy. Chanel number 5.
Available at Marshall Fields.
Centuries, women have impatiently waited for the men they loved to return from the sea. At Christmas time, there's no better way to express that love than a gift of Old Spice. Old Spice, fresh, clean, masculine, sensual. A wonderful gift for a man, a wonderful way to please a woman. This Christmas, give Old Spice to someone you love.
Robes
and slippers
and slippers
and robes
all on sale at Sears
for just $14.99.
Snuggly sleepers with matching feet
or cuddly robes with hoods.
That's neat.
Just $14.99. Save $5. Colors galore at such a low price, you're sure to want more.
Great for gifts they'll remember.
Now through the 20th of December.
Robes
and slippers
and slippers
and robes
all on sale at Sears. Just $14.99.
Sears, where America shops for gifts of value.
The State Department said today the United States detected no change during the weekend in the Soviet military deployment around Poland. However, this promises to be yet another tension-filled week in Poland. And for the story, we go back to Warsaw and Peter Jennings. Peter?
Here in Poland at the beginning of another week, attention is still focused on three things: food, domestic politics, and the pressure to minimize reform from elsewhere in the Soviet bloc. In Moscow today, the Soviet press said it saw no threat from political and economic reform. It did see danger in what it called Western support for anti-communists here. Well, today in Warsaw, a Western visitor who was more than welcome, the American industrialist Armand Hammer, came to do business. Here's ABC's John McKenzie.
Armand Hammer is the first American to meet Poland's new Communist Party leader. He told Stanislav Kania that he came with a message of peace from the United States. The two men spent more than an hour in private talks, during which Kania insisted the Soviet Union posed no threat to Poland.
He just stated unequivocally the Russians did not, had not, were not intending to invade Poland. He thinks this whole situation has been blown all out of proportion.
The 82-year-old chairman of Occidental Petroleum is here primarily to sell Poland an array of agricultural products. Kania told him most of this country's resources are now going into agriculture and that Poland hoped the United States would help by providing much-needed credits.
Poland's leader told Hammer he had heard great things about President-elect Reagan and was optimistic about future good relations between Poland and the United States. John McKenzie, ABC News, Warsaw. And now, the open sore that is the Polish economy.
In Poland, this is the age of scarcity. No one is starving, but in the faces of the elderly, you can often see that they have before. Getting what you want to eat today is a good deal more personal than the threat of Soviet intervention. The endless lines symbolize the economic need. There is a shortage of everything. By February, meat will be rationed. Milk, eggs, oil, butter, beets, sugar, and chocolate may be somewhere at the end of this line, but very often they are not. The Polish economic dilemma is a pattern of interlocking vicious circles. One example. This is Poland's seventh bad harvest in a row. Bad weather is particularly devastating because there are no programs nor any hard currency to invest in drainage. Half of this year's potato production has been spoiled. Poland is the world's second largest exporter of coal, and it produces hard currency. But coal production is down 7% in the last 6 months. It is down, ironically, because miners demanded and got shorter working hours. Poland has a staggering foreign debt of $21 billion. Poland may be able to pay the interest next year, but do virtually nothing more. The government of Stanislav Kania promised, under immense union pressure, that this time there will be economic reform. At the largest independent union's headquarters, they say they've heard it all before. The need for reform is all too clear. The need for decentralization and incentive programs, some process by which to motivate a deprived and sometimes hungry workforce. A measure of free enterprise works already. at the Praga market on the edge of Warsaw, the evidence of compromise in the socialist state. You can buy food here direct from a private farmer. All it takes is more money, a reward for the private farmer's incentive. You can buy veal in this private market for about $4.50 a pound. You can buy it in the government shop for about 50 cents a pound, if you could ever find it. The government does not act against these private markets because to do so would further reduce the source of supply. Poles would like nothing more than an economic plan in which they could believe. The government has made a little progress by telling the truth. On television, no longer is it a diet of success propaganda. Every Pole now knows just how bad things are. One thing is clear. If there is no material improvement in Polish lives, there will be political chaos again, and the limited freedoms they have won could be eliminated. Well, throughout Poland today, many people are waiting for tomorrow and the dedication of this monument in the port city of Gdansk. It commemorates workers killed during the food riots in 1970. It will be a day charged with emotion. The Communist Party paper has appealed for calm, and the vast majority of Poles would like it to be a time for healing old wounds, not opening new ones. Max?
Well, in economic news in this nation, Chrysler will meet with the UAW tomorrow and is expected to ask the union to accept the wage freeze. This as Chrysler tries to cut costs before asking the federal government for more loan guarantees. Meanwhile, Chrysler's sales were up about 2.5% during the first 10 days of the month, but that's still far short of what the company needs to stay afloat. Overall, sales for the big three fell 7%. Two more airlines, Eastern and Braniff, revealed today they're talking about a possible merger. Both airlines lost money during the first three quarters of this year. And one final economic note, news today of a wage settlement that's considerably larger than the old wage guidelines. Dick Schaff reports.
Dave Winfield wore a big smile and a banker's suit, both of which were appropriate.
I have signed with the New York Yankees today, and I'm very pleased and proud to say that I am part of that organization.
The precise terms were not announced, but Dave Winfield had every reason to be pleased. Depending on which rumor you believed, the 6'6", 29-year-old bachelor had signed a complicated contract that, besides funding the Winfield Foundation to help disadvantaged youngsters, would earn Winfield himself between $12 and $15 million spread over the next 8 to 10 years. Dave Winfield is now the highest paid player in baseball history. Not bad for a man whose vital baseball statistics in his first 8 major league seasons are far from awesome. He has hit as many as 30 home runs only once, has driven in 100 or more runs only once, has batted over 300 only twice, and who last year, even by his own standards, had an off season. Winfield is only the second baseball player to be guaranteed a yearly income of $1 million or more. The only other is Nolan Ryan of the Houston Astros, who last season, the first of his million-dollar seasons, celebrated the Astros' generosity by winning 11 games and losing 10, far from a million-dollar performance. George Steinbrenner, the owner of the Yankees, certainly expects better things from Winfield, for whom he is paying more than he paid for Catfish Hunter and Reggie Jackson combined.
Everything's gone up, Dick. I can't buy a newspaper or a loaf of bread anymore without paying a lot more than I used to, so you can't, or a milkshake.
7 years ago, George Steinbrenner was a member of a syndicate that purchased the New York Yankees for less money than he has now promised to pay Dave Winfield. That tells you more about inflation in one sentence than all the economists in Washington. Dick Schaap, ABC News, New York.
How are we coming, dear?
Just fine. Darn these hands.
Your minor arthritis pain is acting up. What this pain needs is Bayer aspirin, 100% pure pain reliever. 100% pure aspirin. And remember, for arthritis pain, doctors recommend aspirin 4-to-1 over any other non-prescription medication.
Honey, you look terrific.
For hours of relief, Bayer aspirin, 100% pure pain reliever for arthritis pain.
This front-wheel drive Plymouth Reliant K Coupe has America's highest 6-passenger mileage, priced at $58.80, with this rich, custom pleated interior. Equip Reliant the way you want. Automatic transmission, power steering, deluxe wheel covers, white walls, AM radio. Choose the ones you want or take them all for only $65.95. Four-door, $100 additional at your Chrysler Plymouth dealer.
Now Chrysler fights high interest rates with 6% off all new 81 cars. Get $325 to $1,000 direct.
For most people, their home is their biggest investment.
but it's only worth as much as a buyer is able to pay. And lately, many people have discovered it's hard to find a qualified buyer, mainly because there's a shortage of mortgage money. That's why at Savings and Loans, we're introducing a variety of new mortgages designed to increase the supply of mortgage money. Because we want to make sure your biggest investment will always be your best investment.
Hello. I was a dedicated blade shaver till my wife bought me this Remington microscreen shaver because it would shave as close as a blade or your money back. The first microscreen is so thin, it shaves incredibly close. The second, even closer. And Remington's American-made. It costs less. Norelco's imported. It costs much more. I was so impressed, I bought the company. The Remington microscreen shaves as close as a blade, or I'll give you your money back.
And the Lady Remington, the perfect gift, also with a money-back guarantee.
Here in Washington today, both the House and Senate tried to send the 96th Congress on its way to history. But the end of this lame duck session of Congress has been marked by something less than a spirit of goodwill between both houses. Here is a report from Capitol Hill correspondent Catherine Mackin.
The congressional pay raise, that's what has things in a mess here. The House members want it and voted for it. The Senate, some of them want it, but almost none of them are willing to vote for it. Held hostage is a huge federal spending bill that must be passed before midnight tonight, or much of the government grinds to a halt. So as the two sides met today for the third day, each side stonewalled the other, the House refusing to give the Senate a bunch of juicy amendments the Senate wants for the folks back home, harbor dredging, courthouses, and the like. The Senate refusing to budge on a pay raise. Said Stennis of Mississippi, talk of a pay raise was blowing like a hot wind when he was home over the weekend. Proxmire of Wisconsin said 100 people stopped him at a Green Bay football game to talk about it.
It is generally felt that this is no time to put ourselves a pay raise when interest rates are 20%, when inflation is double digit, and when we are trying to contain that inflation.
The pay raise is dead. It's just a question of what the version of the continuing resolution will be. We must pass one before midnight tonight.
As efforts for compromise continued through the day and into the evening, the talk was Congress will pass a stripped-down spending bill. No special interest amendments, no congressional pay raise. It seems that spite, stonewalling, and ill will between the two houses of Congress could bring forth something that almost never happens around here. Some savings for taxpayers. Catherine Mackin, ABC News, the Capitol.
The Supreme Court had good news today for all federal judges, including themselves. The court ruled that Congress and the President had no right to withhold two of the four pay raises granted over the past few years. That means most federal judges will receive an increase of at least $7,000 a year, plus approximately $8,000 in back pay. Peter?
In other news overseas, 23 more men have begun a hunger strike in Northern Ireland. They join seven other IRA prisoners who've been fasting for 50 days in an attempt to get political prisoner status. The British government refuses to grant it, saying it would give political respectability to terrorism. The original seven, now in a prison hospital, are said to be in serious condition. In Italy today, effects of the earthquake linger on. In Naples, a building which had been damaged by the recent quake collapsed. It had been used as an old people's home. Eight elderly women and a social worker were killed. Finally, in Uganda today, Milton Obote is formally president once again. Uganda's first president after independence, who was overthrown by Idi Amin, was formally sworn in after his party won last week's election. President Obote, in an appeal for political unity, said, "We either rise or sink together."
Sometimes when you're really loaded down, opening your umbrella can be a problem. But not with Totes one-hand automatic. Just push the button, Totes opens automatically, just like that. Look again. Push the button, it's open. And it's big enough to shelter two. Beautiful designer colors and prints. Totes is windproof, built to last, and it folds fast. Small enough to fit in your handbag.
The Totes one-hand push-button automatic. A great gift.
If a man's slacks fit him too close for comfort, if he just can't stand to sit, then he needs Levi's Action Slacks, perhaps the most comfortable slacks a man can wear. The waistband and fabric stretch to give you more room when you need
it. Comfortable?
Comfortable. I could sit through a double feature now.
Levi's Action Slacks from Levi's Sportswear, where quality never goes out of style.
Hello, I am Napoleon Bonaparte.
It's been like this all winter. Eat and run. Look, a new canal. When I finally get 5 minutes to eat, what do I eat? Wet snow and cold beans. It's enough to give even an emperor an upset stomach.
Upset stomach? Pepto-Bismol. It coats, soothes, relieves.
I hope the food is better at Waterloo.
While Ronald Reagan relaxed today at his ranch near Santa Barbara in the state capitals across the nation, like here in Indianapolis, members of the Electoral College formally elected Reagan President of the United States. There were no last-minute switches in loyalty as they cast their votes. The final tally was the one predetermined in the general election November 4th. Reagan, 489 electoral votes. President Carter, 49. Right?
Ever since the day after the November election, the major story in this town has been the transition from the Carter to the Reagan administration. But there has also been news of a sort involving the problems of transition from one first family to the next. More on that from White House correspondent Sam Donaldson.
The Carters and the Reagans began patching up campaign hard feelings late last month. But in the last few days, a large rip has developed in the patch. On Friday, reporter Helen Thomas quoted sources as saying Nancy Reagan couldn't understand why the Carters don't move out of the White House early to make room for the Reagan decorator to get started on redoing the family quarters. White House sources were furious. Mrs. Reagan's press secretary, Robin Orr, said Nancy Reagan had not suggested the Carters move out early, only that when the Reagans' time is up, they might move out early as a favor to their successor's decorator. On Saturday, Robin Orr resigned as Mrs. Reagan's press secretary, and the Reagans went back to the White House with their decorator, but only to look, not touch.
Well, you can't move in until the 20th.
Then today, an interview given by the Reagans' 22-year-old son, Ron, surfaced, in which he said he will not shake hands with President Carter because he is quoted as saying, Carter would have sold his mother to get reelected. He has the morals of a snake. Today, as she showed off the White House Christmas tree, Rosalind Carter said she had received a telephone call from Nancy Reagan.
She called me to say that she did not say the things that had been reported, and I told her that I had not worried about
it. Were you troubled by the somewhat less than gracious remarks by President-elect Reagan's son that he wouldn't shake Carter?
I think, let's talk about Christmas.
So the Carters won't move out until January 20th. Nancy Reagan is looking for a new press secretary for herself and perhaps for the Reagan son, Ron. And here at the White House, where they're doing nothing but talking about Christmas, not a creature is stirring. Certainly no one's interior decorator. Sam Donaldson, ABC News, the White House.
Thank you, Sam. Once again, tonight's top story. The OPEC ministers reportedly have agreed to a $2 to $3 a barrel increase in the price of their crude oil. That should mean another 2 cents a gallon increase in this country. That's our report for now on World News Tonight for ABC News. Good night.
From ABC, this has been World News Tonight.
Hi, all. This is Kermit the Frog, and I'm here to tell you the story about Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas.
Monday at 8, 7 Central, a special holiday treat for the whole family when Jim Henson's marvelous Muppets bring Christmas to Frogtown Hollow in Emmett Otter's Jug Band Christmas.
Tonight.